it. Cut out them last for me. We gon' limit in my frequency. You can't keep track of me. Lyrical audacity, creating animosity. Life is built in property with proper terminology. Boom! Welcome to the Righteous Rebel Show, where we preach the word, teach the word, listen to some tunes, and start a revolution. My God!
Yes, yes, yes. We are back. We are back to the Righteous Rebel. Every other Saturday, every other Saturday, every other Saturday. Today in a special time. Today is special time, 8 a.m. But normally it's 10 a.m. I'm here with Ref Renn. Renn, how you doing today, brother?
Pretty good, man. What's going on with you?
Not much. Another Saturday, man. Another Saturday waiting for the Righteous Rebel, enjoying this. What we got today, man? What we got for the people?
Oh, man. Today we got something kind of like different, something a little extra, a little crazy. But I think it's going to be good, and it's going to really hopefully open up the eyes of some people today. So I'm excited.
Let's go then. Let's go, because I'm excited. I know whoever's tuning in right now, they're very excited themselves. So let's do this.
What's up? Cool. All right. So here we go. We're going to pray real quick, and then we'll jump right in. Father God, we just thank you, Lord. We thank you for this day, God. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercy, God. We thank you, God, that even as we spoke about last time, God, you have a plan to prosper us, God. That was always your original intent, God. So we just ask that you would be with us today, God, that you would speak to us, God, that you would give us open ears, Lord God, and an open heart to understand your word, to receive your word, God, and that let it may sit well with us, God. We just give you praise and thanks and ask that you would just continually guide us and direct us into all things. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
All right.
Let's do
this. Here we go. So today's topic and what we're going to be talking about is actually kind of an interesting one, and it's actually called Immortal Kombat. And it's basically, you know, derived from what people know as Mortal Kombat. But the reality is that when you become a believer, like now we're fighting an immortal combat. So we're just going to talk about that. We're going to start a little bit off in the beginning and how we were initially created and then kind of progress into the actual battle. So the first part in the first scripture, which is the core scripture for the message, is that, and it says in 1 Corinthians 15:50, now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. So that's basically saying, you know, our natural body, our physical body that can corrupt will not be able or capable to enter into heaven, which is an eternal place. So then what actually happens to this body? What happens to this flesh? And why aren't we designed, I guess, with the capacity to be eternal or live forever? All right. So the first part we're going to talk about is what made us mortal beings, right? Like man is created. And when he was made basically with a body, a soul, and a spirit. But the fall of man, right, is basically what made us finite, right? That basically reduced our capacity to live forever. So you see that originally God actually created man with an immortal, supernatural capacity within him. But after the fall, you know, people just started to degenerate, right? We used to actually be able to live to 1,000 years old. Like most of the people that were born back then, they lived to like 950, I think Noah, and then 969, which is Methuselah, which was the oldest person in the Bible. And they had their kids when they were like 150. Like, that's ridiculous. It's like, imagine a 100-year-old man today having a child at 150 or 300 and things like that. Like, it's ridiculous, you know, but the reality was that the life component and how they were connected to God basically didn't allow them to age or didn't allow them to degenerate. If anything, they were connected to the source of life, and all they did was just continually live and thrive and just keep on going all the way up to 900 something. So if the average age for man was like 1,000 just to begin with, and then after the fall, you could see that God said that his spirit, right, will not always thrive with man. And then it was reduced to 120 years in Genesis chapter 6. So because we got disconnected from God's divine source, from God's design, will, and intention, even like we talked about last time in Paradise Calling, God's original intent was never to have us go down this dark road and to end up in this fallen, like, you know, like decomposing world. His plan was always paradise for us. But because of our free will and choice, we took a different course But God is, by Jesus, is redirecting us back to that paradise calling and trying to engraft immortality back into our system. Right? Like, that is what God is intending to do. And that's why Jesus said, I've come to give you life and that more abundantly, and eternal life. So we're just going to talk about how are we made up, and then we're going to get into how do we get back to immortality. Right? So the first part is that in 1 Thessalonians 5:23, it says, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Right? So we are created and we're made with a spirit, which is what actually gets regenerated when we get saved, right? When we fell into sin and the fall, our spirit died, right? But then when we get born again, our spirit gets reborn. Our soul and our body, which is our soul, is our mind, intellect, and our emotions, doesn't actually get reborn, right? And our body doesn't get reborn. Like, when you got saved, you did not turn back into a baby, or you didn't get any younger or any cuter. You know, like, the reality was, is that it was only your spirit man that got reborn. So that's just to say, and it's per the scripture, in terms of like scientifically trying to assess the composition of man, the word of God says, may your spirit, soul, and body, right? Some people say we're mind, body, and soul, or different things like that. But if you look at the scriptures a little bit more accurately, precisely, it's always described as spirit, soul, and body. Another scripture that references it is that it says, the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing between spirit, soul, and flesh, or the joint and marrow of the bone, which is the body component. So you start to see in the scriptures, anytime we're talking about the makeup of man, it's spirit, soul, and body. So we can determine from that, or derive, is that man is a spirit, right? We're a spirit being. We have a soul, and we live in a body. So if we're trying to understand that correctly, we are spirit beings, right? It says God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. But we have a soul, which is the part, which is our personality, which is the component of us that will go to heaven, and that we live in a body. All right? So in terms of just kind of continually building on this to get laid a foundation, is that like the spirit is the root of man, right? If you could think about like a tree has roots, and our roots are what go down like into the river or into the ground to pull up life. So when we connect to God, he's that source of life, and our spirit is what connects to God. You could also think about it that like your spirit connects to the spiritual realm, right? Your soul connects to like the eternal realm, and your body connects to the physical realm. Okay? So your soul part is kind of like the trunk of the tree, which basically allows you to kind of take what you get from God's spirit and then start to put actions into motion, and then like your body is what actually on outwardly manifests the fruit of the spirit. Right? So the fruit of the spirit is the spirit of God, but it has to transfer from God, go through your soul, your mind, intellect, and your emotions before it comes out, you know, to be a full-blown, like, actual manifestation of the spirit, which is the fruit. So comprehending that, we're just going to keep on building on the fact that when God recreated us, he wanted us to regain that supernatural immortal capacity. But the problem is that we, as humans, we have this, after the fall, we have this now natural, fleshly, temporal limitation, right? Everybody knows that humans are human, and when they're born nowadays, after the fall, is that we are destined to die. We're destined to decompose and go to the grave. But what actually happens at the grave, or what happens to people who either are saved or don't get saved, right? And the Bible says that at death, right, in this temporal world, at death, the Bible says our souls go down to the grave, right? It also says, you know, in another scripture that the dead in Christ will rise first, right? So we got souls, the souls of man, because of mortality, are eventually going to die. And that soul part that I was just telling you about is going to go down to the grave. But those souls that go down to the grave, if you died in Christ, will rise when Jesus returns. So in actuality, because the final judgment hasn't occurred, the souls of man really are biblically, what we discover is that they're still lingering or in a hole or near, like basically in a holding pattern at the cemetery. So at the cemetery, right, is where, if you've ever been to a cemetery, I think most people could tell that you feel like something's there and it's something kind of eerie, right? Or you feel like there's like life, but it's dead. And, you know, you get a sense that it's not just a natural plane that's going on in that area. But Jesus said when he returns and at the final judgment that he's going to separate the sheep from the goat. And he's also going to do it per the names that are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. So if we look at the scripture to kind of quantify and to, like, you know, solidify this fact, is that it says in Ezekiel 37:13, then you shall know that I am the Lord when I have opened your graves, O my people, and brought you up from your graves. Right? So when you die, it says that God, you know, he will bring you up from your grave. And James also says that life is like a vapor. You're here today and gone tomorrow. So when we talk about winning souls, what we're saving is that component of man that is his mind, intellect, and emotion, which is basically the essence or the main makeup of our person once this natural body and flesh decomposes. And it's kind of like the essence of our personality, like who you are beyond the flesh is your soul. And that's the part that is going to be saved and redeemed and live forever in heaven. So the good news is, and what's actually great about what Jesus did is that he already paid the price for us, right? He already paved the way for us to inherit this eternal life. But on this side of heaven, what we're actually doing is that before you get saved, I don't know if there's many people out there who remember when you were just about to get saved, if all hell broke loose for you, right? Like if everything started going crazy, or if, like, you know, you were trying to get to church and all of a sudden, like, you know, somebody invited you to the club or to the bar or whatever. And there was just like this, there was this mortal battle for your immortality, right? Because it doesn't become easy to get saved unless you were born in church. But even people that are born in church still have struggles and battles throughout. But a lot of people who, before they get saved, you know, they almost end up with the wrong person, or they almost, like, you know, commit suicide, or like they're basically at their breaking point, which is the mortal side of this immortal combat. So while you're mortal or while you're unsaved, you are fighting for immortality, right? To the concept of being saved so you can live eternally. So the good majority of the fight, right, actually starts off in the mortal realm. But then after we get saved, we transition now, being saved, we become immortal, right? Because if we were to die now, you know, like naturally, we would go to heaven, right? Or we would go and we know that we died with eternal life. So we live as immortal beings now in an immortal fight, or in a fight for the life and the souls that we just talked about of others, so that way they can inherit immortality, right? The whole message of the gospel or the Great Commission is to go out into all the world and to win the lost, right? The lost souls, but then to guide them to Christ and the cross so that way they can become immortal. So the real saints of God are now part of this immortal combat, and they are the ones that are basically part of God's immortal army in the earth, right? You know how the scripture says we are not of this world, right? That we are from a different kingdom. So we're basically an immortal army that God has ordained, that is of God, that is present in this earth. So we're going to kind of like stop it right there before we go into our first song. And what I want you guys to gather from this part, just at least initially, is that the battle is already won, right? It's already done. And if you have received Christ, you're at that place of accepting immortality. But now we're going to kind of discover, how do we fight, you know, after we become immortal, and how do we win this war, you know, after the fact that Jesus already initially granted us the victory. All right, so check this one out. This is basically Already Done by Kevin Downswell featuring Ryan Mark.
Don't go nowhere. This is the Rise Shows Rebel Show here in RadioNT.net. Let's go.
Ryan Mark, Kevin Downswell. I don't know who you are. I don't know where you are, but God said to tell you. My friend, you're coming out. You're coming out.
God is speaking. I see you wondering why me, in the midst of your adversity. God is speaking. But if you dare trust in me, I will supply all you need. I will take you over. I will take you over. I will never leave. To you I will cleave. I'm standing right there in the midst of sometimes I don't feel like running. Keep pressing, keep pressing. Though sometimes you don't feel like pressing. Keep your eyes on me. Will you trust in me? I will be with you to the end. It's already done. It's already done. The victory is won. It's already.
It's already done.
You're gonna get over this.
I will not die here.
Don't give up.
Even though I cry here.
With Christ,
the victory is won.
You're more than a conqueror.
It's already
finish well.
Done.
My brother, Ryan Mark.
Yes, 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 yes. We are back. We are back to the Righteous Rebel Show every other Saturday. Every other Saturday at 10 a.m. Today with a special show, a special time, 8 a.m. for you guys. I got Rev Renn with me. Renn, man, what a powerful word. But we got more. And that was just the beginning. That was just to get you guys going. Now Renn is coming with the hard stuff, ain't it?
Yep. So here we go. We're about to jump right back in. So we just talked about, like, basically, you know, that was already done by Kevin Downswell and Ryan Mark. And those guys are just talking about, like, you know, like, it's already done. The victory is won. You know, and we just got to recognize that. Like, sometimes we just keep on living as though, like, you know, Jesus is, we're just waiting for Jesus to come back, and he didn't already do this major work. He didn't already defeat the devil and just leave us and basically handed us a crown of victory. So right now, when you get saved, you're wearing your crown, right? You're wearing the crown of salvation. And Jesus says in Revelation, don't let anybody take your crown. Right. You know, and if you make it to the end, if you endure the rest of the, I guess, the aftermath of the battle, then, you know, you literally will be going to heaven. So now let's talk about the actual spiritual combat, right? The immortal combat and how that goes down after Jesus actually won this battle and actually after he's granted us the victory. So really where the real battle lies now is that we're not here to try to defeat the devil. Right? Like, we live, sometimes you hear a lot of Christians, oh, I'll stomp down the devil, stomp down the devil, you know, and their whole, like, service is about, like, focused on trying to beat up this guy who has already been demolished, right, by Jesus. So we have to recognize now, all we're really fighting is to get rid of our remaining residual sinful fleshy nature that's still trying to reside in us. But when Jesus gave us the Holy Spirit, it was so that our flesh could be subdued as well, right? Jesus basically won the battle and then gave us the what we needed, you know, the ability, the catalyst to try to actually not even just suppress the flesh, because that's what a lot of Christians do. They live by trying to suppress their flesh. They're not trying to gain dominion over their flesh. They're not really sometimes trying to conquer the flesh completely. When you conquer something, it's done, right? So when you start to mature in Christ, what you're trying to do is actually mortify the deeds of the flesh. When you mortify something, you're killing it, right? So you, the Spirit of God in you should be killing your flesh. It shouldn't be the other way around. You know how many people say, oh, this, you know, the Spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak, you know? And then it's just like, okay, how about the other way around? How about the, you know, the flesh is weak, but the Spirit of God is willing, you know, and the Spirit of God is able to the point where it can subdue your flesh. And, you know, the scripture supports it all throughout 1 John and so forth. And it talks about basically, you know, that a child that is born of God, that has the seed of God inside of him, sinneth not. So we're supposed to be progressing, believing by faith, trusting in God, receiving more of his Holy Spirit to purify, cleanse this temple, to this temple is capable of, you know, now subduing the flesh and sin not having dominion over us. Jesus died so we would have dominion over the devil, right? Because he's granted us all authority and power over the devil, but he's also granted us authority and power over this sinful flesh nature, which was not even supposed to be ours. So that's why this immortality, you know, or like how the scripture says that mortality has to put on immortality, right? So we're working now in a process of defeating the flesh, but we're also still in a world that is obviously crazy and, you know, and sick and dying and has issues. So we're also fighting against the world and the spiritual powers, but you can't fight a spiritual battle with natural means. Right. So when you become immortal, you have to fight like an immortal person. Right. When you lived as a finite person, you fought as a finite person. But now that you've become an infinite person, you have to fight like an infinite person. So the scripture is we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and rulers of darkness and wickedness in high places. So these rulers and principalities are domains, they're, you know, positions of authority that are spiritual, but the way we fight them are spiritual. So the same way Jesus defeated the devil in a spiritual matter is the same way that we must also fight in like manner as Jesus did to overcome demons, to overcome fallen man's nature, or when people have illnesses. Like, we have to overcome and fight these battles, fight these demons off, and fight off this world that we're in through spiritual means. So we have to recognize that we've been granted the victory, we've been empowered for it. And the sad part, I think, is that some people that are unsaved are still stuck in this mortal realm, fighting a battle that they are in, a battle that they don't even know that they should be fighting, right? When you're deceived, when you're dead, right? When you're dead in like your spirit, or when you're dead and not reborn of God, you're walking around like a zombie already, right? So you could be spiritually dead and physically alive, you know? So the problem there is that you don't even recognize that there's a fight going on around you. You know, someone I was talking to the other day told me that, you know, there's like a battle, you know, at Washington and all these different places. I think it's Canada also. And it's like, it was like kind of, I guess, you know, not to pick them out, it doesn't make any difference. You know, there's all types of sin and, like, you know, like abortion and all types of different things going on that are wrong, you know. But nonetheless, this one was actually about the LGBT. And it was like two different groups, that and I guess a bunch of like radical saved believers in Christ. And he said the second they said Jesus loves you, it was like an atomic bomb went off. And those LGBT people like started to come out at the Christians with their fangs, because they said something that didn't really mean too much in a natural sense. It was just a few words. But in a spiritual sense, to say Jesus loves you to somebody who may be living in sin is like literally taking like a dagger, you know, like straight to the heart. And that's what happened spiritually. And what it caused was contention in the natural. But spiritually, it was basically a Christian knowing what they were saying intentionally. And hopefully they said it purely out of love. But just saying that spiritual component and saying the name of Jesus, or saying God loves you when you feel convicted of sin, has the power to do a lot of, you know, good, but it also stirs the spiritual realm up and starts things to contend in the spiritual, you know, in the spirit. But the sad part, like I said before, is that the mortal person doesn't even recognize that they should be looking to gain eternal life, right? So it's almost like if you're fighting in the blind in this world until somebody removes the bandana from your eyes and allows you to see that there is more. So when you get saved, you recognize that there is more to life, and then you start to gain your immortality while others are basically running full speed ahead to their damnation and chasing after temporal ideas of success and earthly material things, knowing that they are going to go to a grave, but they're just trying to gather up as many coins and tickets as they can before they go there, not recognizing that you can overcome death and you can go, I guess, as the Bible says, you know, you can live on and kind of go past the, I guess, the first death, you know, and make it to the judgment. So how do we do that? How do we become immortal, right? The Bible says that corruption must put on incorruption, and this earthly body must put on an eternal home body, right? So right now, the way that scripture describes it in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 4 to 11, is that we're basically a soul in a case, right? Our soul casing is our flesh. But a lot of people get this main part, and this one I want to zoom in on, is that they always say, well, when I die, I'm going straight to heaven, right? I'm like, okay, well, where do you see that? You know, like, what about the judgment? So do you get like a free pass? Do you get to like skip the judgment and you just going straight to heaven the second you die? So does that mean that everybody that has died before us is in heaven right now? I don't know if that's fully scripturally supported, and I want to kind of lay out the scriptures for you. You guys can make your own determination. I'm not here to control you. I'm here to teach you the best I can. So what I've seen in the scripture, and where most people kind of get thrown off, they always take this scripture that says, rather to be absent from the body and present with the Lord, right? And they say, okay, well, Jesus said that the dead in Christ will rise first at his return. Jesus has not returned yet. So the dead in Christ, right, he's basically saying, hold on a minute, those that are dead in me, and those that these martyrs and these apostles and these people who we have 2,000 years worth of Christians in the grave right now, and then after we go into the grave, we're probably maybe, depending on God's will, we'll have hundreds of years of people going into the grave afterwards, right? So you're in the back of the line. You know, I hate to break it to you, you know, like we are in the back of the bus right now, waiting for the bus to glory, you know, the train, you know, and the people who died for the and who got martyred for the faith or who just died in Christ, they are in the front of the line. So we got 2,000 years worth of people, you know, stacked up for when Jesus comes, that we will all be called up into the sky. But like the scripture said earlier, they, when we die, we go down to the grave, right? And then we wait. You know, and let's just like, let's talk about that. Let's jump into that and kind of and discover that, like, maybe what the scripture is saying a little bit more deeply. So it says, for we who are in this tent groan, being burdened, not because we want to be unclothed, right? The tent being our body, not because we want to be unclothed, but further that we want to be clothed in immortality, that mortality may be swallowed up by life. Right. So when you get born again, mortality gets swallowed up by life. Right. Now, he who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who also has given us the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, as a guarantee. So we are always confident, knowing that while we are at home in the body, right? Being at home in the body means your soul is still inside your body, which is your temporary natural home here on earth. In the body, we are absent from the Lord. So when we are inside of our body, that means we are absent from God, right, in heaven. For we walk by faith and not by sight. Yes, we are confident. Yes, well pleased rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. So that's to say that our aim and our desire is to leave this body, right? Like, you know how many times you always feel like, man, I can't just wait till Jesus returns. I can't just wait, you know, till the trumpet sounds so I can just go to heaven. That scripture is more so emphasizing the fact that it says, yes, well, please, I rather be absent from the body and be present with the Lord. It's not saying that to be absent from the body is like directly present with the Lord. It's making sure that you understand that it's true. But it's not saying that instantly when you die that you're going to be present. It's that we desire to be present. But scripturally, we're going to dig a little bit deeper and see that scripturally it says that when we do die, that we stay in the grave until Jesus returns. And then there's actually a sample of what's to come when Jesus dies on the cross. So then it says, therefore, we make it our aim, rather if we are present or absent from the body, to be well-pleasing to him. right? So whether we're dead or alive, right, we're basically, our goal is to still to glorify him and to please him. For we must all appear, right? And this is where it changes a position and direction. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, right? So if the judgment seat has not happened, we are not at the throne yet. That each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men, or we try to win souls in this immortal combat, but we are well known to God, and I also trust are well known in your consciences. Right? So that's basically saying that we have to die first, and then we have to go to the judgment seat. But in the meantime, we'll still be presently here until Jesus resurrects, or until Jesus returns, which he will be doing soon. So the opening of the grave and the judgment must occur first. And then how that's supported a little bit further is in Matthew chapter 27, 50 to 53. And it said, and this is when Jesus went to the cross, and Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Right? Then behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth quaked, and the rocks were split, and the graves were opened. And many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep, which is dead, were raised. And coming out of their graves after his resurrection, right? You see that? They were coming out of the grave after his resurrection. They went into the holy city, heaven, and appeared to many. So right there, we get a sample of Jesus dying and then resurrecting. And when he did that, some of the graves were cracked open, and maybe who God wanted to take with him presently, just to prove that he is the King of all kings initially, and how it's going to go down in the long run. He cracked open the graves after his resurrection, and there were actually some people, a group of people, as it describes here, that went to the holy city, right? So you can see that. And then what you're going to see in the long term when Jesus returns is that when he does come, it says all the dead in Christ will rise first, the same similar way, just like this, and then they will be caught up in the sky to him. Okay? So that's basically declaring that part so that way people can understand and kind of recognize what happens to the soul of man after we die, and whether we're going to be judged for good or for bad, or whether we're going to inherit immortality fully, or if we're going to stay and inherit like eternal, you know, condemnation. So now how do we actually fight this battle, right? Like, how do we stay engaged? How do we continue to win in this victory over the flesh? And how do we combat mortality right now? Because we are mortal, you know, and maybe some people think, wow, this is a very futuristic message. But nonetheless, like, you are immortal right now on earth. And that's what I want you to comprehend and understand. You have to learn to fight off mortality as you become immortal, and you have to maintain your immortality until Jesus returns. So the first thing we have to do is we have to put on the armor of God, which is a spiritual component, which is a spiritual armor that allows us to contend. The Bible says that the sword of the Spirit, right, the word of God, is able to divide through joint, marrow, right, spirit, and like through flesh. So it's literally like the word of God can cut you so deep. It can go beyond, you know, like it can cut your soul in half, right? So you have to recognize that the Spirit, the Word of God, is there to chisel your soul, to build it. And it's also there to contend against spiritual forces of wickedness. We also need to learn how to pull down strongholds and combat all the lies of the enemy, right? One of the biggest lies, and I'm kind of jumping ahead, is that, you know, like, you ever heard the term YOLO, right? You know, that you only live once. Like, I want to start a movement that says, you know, say no to YOLO, because really the reality is that we're not only going to live once. So I want to call it NOLO, like never only live once, right? Because the reality is that, you know, the enemy would like you to believe, just live for now, you know, just die, just go to that grave. So when Jesus comes, he could send you straight to hell with me, right? No, that's not what it's about. The idea is to never only live once, and to recognize that you can't inherit in eternal life and be immortal. So we have to discard these worldly concepts, and we have to promote things that push people in the right direction to recognize that they can be immortal, they can be redeemed, they can be reconciled to their creator. Another part of it is just that we have to be renewed daily, right? Like I told you, your spirit was recreated, but your mind and your body was not. So what you have to do is renew your mind daily, you know, through the word of God, and walk in the spirit. We have to obviously be born of water and of the spirit, and we have to start to transform back into this this casing that God really would have liked for us to maintain for a longer period of time. You know, God had no really intent to kind of like short circuit us and to limit us. Like, he wanted us to be like him. He created us in his image and after his likeness, which was eternal. Right. So we have to kind of keep on building on that. And every day we should be ciphering in more life into us so that way we can get back to where we started and kind of progress to a better place from there. Being revived internally until we shed our flesh off and basically inherit an immortal temple, like that immortal state of being, we can also gain it and gather it in the spirit presently. So that's just to say and to indicate to you guys that even while you're in this fleshly body, you can live like an immortal person. You know, like when I was younger, I used to feel invincible, like I could walk through walls and all different types of stuff. And we only gain that in our innocence and our kind of more pure form when we are walking in the spirit. And when we do that, we can walk around like an immortal being, like cipher in life into others when we pray for them or when they receive the Holy Spirit, you know, and things like that. Or when they receive healing, you're walking around with that virtue that exuded from Jesus when people touched the hem of his garment. That's what's supposed to be evident as it was in the original disciples' lives in your life, right? Like, you don't need a pastor to always lay hands on you. You know, you can let Jesus lay hands on you and you receive from him so that way you can be able to pass on life to others. We have to recognize that we are not of this world and that there is a passageway to heaven and that we're more than conquerors in the spirit through the blood of Jesus that was actually shed on the cross. So we also have to gain and comprehend before we go into this next song is that we've been granted resurrection life as immortal beings now because of Jesus's sacrifice and Jesus conquering death for us, right? Jesus gave us life because he conquered death. He conquered mortality for us. So we've been basically now granted the same supernatural ability to also conquer death by the same spirit that rose Jesus from the dead. So the fact that Jesus, right, being the Messiah, came and conquered death for us, he's also given us the pattern and the dynamics for how we are supposed to now also conquer this thing that's looming before us, which is our death, right? Which is like our grave. We're supposed to say, you know what? I'm not going to go down. I'm going to go over the grave, right? Jesus, like he went down into the tomb, but he resurrected from it. We're all supposed to be able to, when we do have that time, go down into the grave as well, but then resurrect from it. So it's basically like we are surpassing or we're overcoming death. And we're going on beyond death. So it's kind of like if you could think of like a boss at the end of a Mortal Kombat game or something like that, or it's like the big bad guy, like you are supposed to defeat the biggest bad guy that most humans face, which is death, and defeat him. And you don't have to worry about the devil because God got the devil. He already took him out, you know, and defeated him as well. So all your main thing now is to defeat your flesh so that way you can defeat death. And once you defeat death, you will live on totally immortal for eternity with God himself. So your objective right now in this immortal combat is to beat off the things that are still fighting against and trying to keep you mortal. You're not supposed to be in your flesh. You're not supposed to stay mortal. You're supposed to become and live and be immortal. So this next song that we're going to go into is called Soar We Are Soar. And basically what it's saying is that all of our problems, all of these things that try to hold us down, we're designed to go over them. We're designed to soar above death. We're designed to soar above sin. We're designed to soar above mortality and become immortal. So check it out. This is Ryan Mark with Soar We Are Soar.
Danny B, hey, the other day me a praying, I'm going to see this brick wall in front of me. I'm going to say, God, how me going to go through this brick wall? And the Lord says, son, tell the people them say, them not going to go through the brick wall no more. Them are going to go over the wall. Not over the wall, over the wall. All right. Obstacles in our way. Satan now moves, tear it as tear. But we are real Christians, we're not stray. So we take up a Bible for prayer. God said, church, put some more. Me about to give you a outpour. You see the obstacles and pan the floor. Don't worry about them cause I swore you a swore. But what you say? Me say I swore we a swore. Me say I swore we a swore. We a fly. Swore we a swore about we problems. I swore we a swore. We a fly. Swore we a swore. Me say I swore we a swore. We a fly. Swear we are swore about depression. I swore we a swore. We a fly. And your mark gets set. You're not hear nothing yet.
Me a tell us and a worry no fret. God a go give him more than we expect. So read your Bible connect. Make sure your lifestyle it correct. God precepts, don't forget. And a car you a drive, nor a bus you a take. What me say? Me say a swear we a swear. Me say a swear we a swear. We a fly. Swear we a swear about we problems. I swear we a swear. We a fly. Swear we a swear. Me say I swear we a swear. We a fly. Swear we a swear about depression. I swear we a swear. Except I swear like a moonwalker. And chop the scriptures like a smooth talker. Be the light when the world darker. And expose the devil that evil stalker. Come on fire. Well we are real water. Come for baptize with sons and daughters. Say a prayer and fasting will bring water. And nothing can come corrupt the heart. You know why? I swear we are swore. I swear we are swore. We are fly. I swear we are swore about we problems. I swear we are swore. We are fly. I swear we are swore. I swear we are swore. We are fly. I swear we are swore about depression. I swear we are swore. We are fly. I'm of poverty. I'm of sickness. Over every strong word. Obstacles in our way. Satan now moves tear it as tear. But we are real Christians in Australia. So we take up a Bible for prayer. God's a church, push some more. Me about to give you a outpour. You see the obstacles them pan the floor. No worry about them cause I swore you a swore. God, what you say? Me say I swore we a swore. Me say I swore we a swore. We a fly. Swore we a swore about we problems. I swore we a swore. We a fly. Swore we a swore. Me say I swear we are swear we are fly. Swear we are swear by depression. I swear we are swear we are fly. Swear we are swear. Me say I swear we are swear we are fly. Swear we are swear by we problems. I swear we are swear we are fly. Swear we are swear. Me say I swear we are swear we are fly. Swear we are swear by depression. I swear we are swear we are fly.
Righteous Rebel here. Make sure you tune in Saturdays twice a month, 10 a.m. to the Righteous Rebel Show, only on Radio UNT. Keep it locked.
Yes, yes, yes. Just like he said, every other Saturday at 10 a.m. here at RadioUNT.net. Today with a special show at 8 a.m. I'm here with Renn. Brother, we are in the last part of the show. We're closing out, but we got something for them, right? We got something for them.
Yeah, that's it. We're going to finish off strong, all right? So this is the last part, guys. So just get ready for this. And this should hopefully frame out the whole message for you and help you recognize, like, we got to stop living, you know, as though we're just, you know, a bunch of defeated people who just now know that one day we will be in heaven and live in glory. Like, no, we are now fused in with life because of Jesus. We're fusing him with immortality, which is when you have the Holy Spirit and, you know, and you can feel him within you moving, you should recognize that, no, I went from being mortal and defeated, but now I was born again and now I'm alive to the Spirit, right? And now, you know, what happens is that when you are reborn in God, eternally, you die once, but you live twice. Right. So that whole, like I said before, like the whole YOLO concept is whack, is distorted. So the reality is that, you know, we die once, but we live twice. Right. So we live once, we die once, and then we live forever. So we live eternally. We live twice. You know, other people, they live once, they die once. But then, you know, like what is actually true is that, you know, we say die and we talk about immortality, but whether you live for Christ or not, you're going to be immortal in a sense, because you're still going to be alive, whether you're in condemnation or whether you're in eternity. So let's make sure we get that clear, but also recognize that it's much, much better to be living with Christ in eternal bliss than it is to be living in eternal torment. All right. And that's Satan's biggest lie. So I want to tell you just flat out, the biggest thing that what the devil doesn't want you to actually recognize, his biggest distraction, his biggest lie that's out there, you know, and it's not to be taken lightly, and his agenda is for you not to recognize this concept of that you can become immortal. Because the second you become immortal, he loses again and again and again. So every Christian that's out there is basically like stomping on the devil in the sense that Jesus defeated him and they're like kicking him every time they get saved. So every time someone gets saved and moves on to eternity, the devil is like, he's miserable. And that's why he fights so hard before you get saved, because he's losing another one. And all we're doing is re-emphasizing the fact that he was defeated by the eternal king. And we're just stepping on his head again, saying, I'm also going to live forever. Like Jesus is living forever and he already defeated you. And I'm also going to live. And I'm also going to live forever too. And we're just beating him down, even to the point where he's recognizing that more and more people are discovering and evading the lies that he's spewing out there like vomit, you know, and we're becoming wiser and sharper and smarter and stronger, and we're overcoming the enemy by the truth and by the word of God. So let's just talk about again as we're concluding, in John chapter 5 and 24 through 30, it says, "Do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the grace will hear his voice and come forth. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation. I can of myself do nothing," this is Jesus speaking, "as I hear, I judge, and my judgment is righteous, because I do not seek my own will, but the Father who sent me." So this is Jesus saying that the hour is still coming in which all who are in the graves will hear and recognize that Jesus is here, and those who have done good will come to the resurrection of life, will be immortal. But those who have not will go to the resurrection of condemnation or eternal torment in hell. So, you know, you see that that's still to come, whether you get resurrected to life or to death, but you still have to face the judgment seat of Christ, which is still to come. It also says, "In the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for at the trump will sound and the dead will be raised," right? The dead in the graves, in the cemeteries presently, will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. So that's a little thing that we have to focus on there. When you come out of the grave, you will be changed. So what God is saying there is that you're going to die in Christ, you're going to come up from the grave, your soul, and then you're going to be changed and transformed, because this corruptible body, right, must put on incorruption, and this mortal body must put on immortality. So as you can see too, like in Revelation, it also says that God is going to give us a new name and that we're going to receive an immortal body, right? And it's immortal hope, like home casing or soul casing, that will be able to last for eternity. So we're going to basically be changed and converted more fully with our soul into an immortal state, right? So it says, "So when this corruptible has put on incorruption and this mortal has put on immortality, then it shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory," right? This is 1 Corinthians 15, 52 to 54. And then it says, "O death, where is your sting?" Right? The same sting that death was supposed to have, the same sting that was supposed to be that thing that we fear so much as human beings. Like, oh my God, like, I don't know when I'm going to die, you know, and I don't want to die, you know, and a lot of people even run from death and try to like find another way out. But I want to just tell you that the only way out is the same way it was for Noah, right? Like he had to basically allow everything else to die that was before him, and then he had to move on to this new land that God was taking him. As you know, like, you know, Noah is a type and a depiction, a shadow of Jesus to come, and the souls that were inside the ark are going to be the souls of man that are going to be raptured up with Jesus and be taken into a new land to live more eternally and to live more so forever, as compared to being cut off by death, short-circuited, limited, and then dying and being buried, you know, and being left behind, right? We're not designed and we're not called to be left behind. We're called to live forever, but we have to get into that ark, which is Jesus, who is going to take us to the promised land, who's going to take us to heaven. So we have to now put on immortality and keep it on, you know, until Jesus returns. And we have to keep on fighting this battle daily. That's what I want to get across to you guys the most, is that don't let nobody take your crown. Don't let life circumstances. The Bible says, "What shall separate us from the love of God? Shall death, shall persecution, shall peril, shall sword separate us from the love of God?" Do not let anything steal your crown. The crown that you're wearing is a crown of immortality that has been granted to you in Christ, and nothing in this world whatsoever is worth you losing your crown of salvation. Nothing. no person, no bae, no boo, nobody. Nobody's worth you losing your crown. So just keep that on and recognize that you are immortal as you have it received Christ fully presently, and you're going to reign with him eternally. So you have to keep your crown on and make sure that it's set right and that it looks good. All right. So, and I think like what I said, like, you know, the best kept secret of our church, you know, of the church itself, is how to win. Right. The way we win this immortal combat is to follow after the only man in history to ever completely overcome death. The only man to overcome hell, the only man to overcome the grave, which is Jesus, the Son of God. So by accepting him and following his ways precisely is how we actually gain and inherit the same type of eternal life in Christ and become immortals like God in spirit and in truth. Right. So we have to basically walk the road that Jesus walked, leading us to eternity, overcoming death, and then progressing to where he is seated at the right hand of the Father. So that is the pathway that we're supposed to be following. You know, I think sometimes we get lost and we see just what's ahead of us. But remember, you are here to walk the same way Jesus walked so you can inherit and have what Jesus has presently, eternal life with the Father, right? So that's what you have to do. You have to keep on following Christ, follow his ways, follow his wills precisely, so that way you can actually get to where he is. And to be one with the Father, so it is with Jesus, so shall it be with us. So Jesus himself said, you know, in this world you will have tribulation, but take heart. I have overcome the world, and in like manner you shall also overcome. He meant it very seriously. He meant it soberly. And he meant it by faith, knowing that all things are possible. So I think, you know, I could feel it in the spirit that some of you guys still wrestle with the concept of am I immortal, right? And that's why you're supposed to have the confirmation and the seal of the Holy Spirit to prove to you that, yes, like you are sealed, you are redeemed, like you can live on. Like, obviously, that doesn't mean go run out in front of a bus because you want to see Jesus sooner, just for all my, you know, radical people out there. But nonetheless, you have to recognize that if you were to die today, you would be in heaven. And you have to live like that because you are designed to inherit immortality more fully when Jesus returns. So we have that proof, we have that seal and that stamp until the day of redemption in Christ. So the last part before we go into the last song and conclude is that the scripture says, do not be afraid of the one that can kill the body, but to fear the one who can kill the body and still also have power to place the soul in heaven or in hell, which is God. Right? So don't fear natural man. Don't be afraid of dying. Don't be afraid to be killed, you know, naturally, because even if you had to contend for your faith and be a martyr in this immortal combat, you would still have to be with God and face God, and God would be the one to make the final determination of where you go, like eternally, whether your soul goes to heaven or hell. But nonetheless, you don't have to be afraid of mankind. What can man do to you, right? So it's your soul and your spirit that is presently has to maintain this incorruptible state. And you have to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior in order to do that. So now what I want to say is that we have to recognize we have the victory still. We have conquered the flesh, and we should still be conquering the flesh daily, but also that Jesus already won the battle and has granted us eternal life. So we have to live now from this place of victory. And I know it's no easy task, but we still have to do it. And we have to count our blessings daily, remember that we are winning right now, right? So I need you guys to leave this session right here knowing that you're winning right now. Like, you, if you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are winning right now, and you have to keep on winning, and you have to keep on gaining the winning the battle over your flesh and winning the battle over this world, because you rule with Jesus now from being seated in heavenly places. So we should be ruling, reigning, conquering the flesh, and conquering any remaining facet of death or of sin that, you know, doesn't belong to us. And we should be taking dominion over these things now, because we are living immortal beings ruling and reigning with God, and we're winning right now. So this is the last song that I want you guys to hear. It's called Winning Right Now, and it's from Agent Sasko, and he's talking about living in victory and recognizing that we are going from glory to glory. So check out Winning Right Now by Agent Sasko. God bless. I'm a winner. 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 I'm a winner
say we're winning right now. Then forget that show up into what we're living right now. Cause I'm winning right now, yeah. And I'm chilling right now. Oh, we're winning right now. At Thanksgiving right now. Cause we're winning right now, yeah. Hell, I'm a walking W. Learn from the L's. Turn them in a medal in a trophy that bells. Every day you see we with them on our next film. Break records like we crack the next shells. And every single ounce of effort we expel. It's all about progress, cause we have to excel. I watch them looking like success, we dress well. Boop. Another knockout for the ring the next bell. I'm about to send my haters a card to get well, cause I'm sick of it. Lord, I'm so sick of it. But that's the whole gist of it. I yet in on the beauty when we didn't have it. Cause I'm winning. Oh, we're winning right now, you be. Say we're winning right now. Then forget that trophy to what we're living right now. Cause I'm winning right now, yeah. And I'm chilling right now. Oh, we're winning right now. At Thanksgiving right now, yeah. I said we're winning right now. So every day you see we be at the reigning champ. And at the cloud with the silver line we're reigning from. Cause if you see some of the places where we're hailing from, it's just the type of place we should be failing from. But now we're winning. Yes, every quarter we're winning. Hold it for tracks and then I fell if I'm swimming. You know that there's no giving in, no matter the circumstances we're living in. You hear me? I'm winning. I'm winning. I'm winning. Oh, we're winning right now, hear me? Say we're winning right now. Me forget that trouble. Cause I'm winning right now, yeah. And I'm chilling right now. Cause oh, we're winning right now. I thanks for giving right now, God. I said we're winning right now.